Let's suppose we have an object that is oscillating back and forth along some pathway. So it begins in some initial position, goes to a final position, and continues going back and forth. Now, if the restoring force acting on the object that's creating that oscillation is directly proportional to the displacement of that object, in other words, the restoring force acting on the object obeys Hooke's law, well then our object is said to undergo simple harmonic motion. So the oscillation is known as simple harmonic. So one example of an object undergoing simple harmonic motion is a mass that is hanging from a spring that is oscillating back and forth. So if we take the following mass, if we pull it down and we let go, our mass will continue oscillating under simple harmonic motion. Now, let's suppose we take the mass, we bring the mass down, we let go, but right before we let go, we take a stopwatch and we press that stopwatch. So we let go, press the stopwatch, and the object will continue oscillating back and forth. Now let's suppose at some time t, we press on that stopwatch. We want to determine a function for position of the mass of the object as it's oscillating with respect to time. So does such a function exist such that if I take my time value, I plug that time value into my equation, and the result gives me the exact position of my object as it's moving along its oscillating pathway? So to answer this question, let's begin with Newton's second law of motion. The sum of the forces acting on the mass along the y-axis is equal to the mass of the object multiplied by the object's instantaneous acceleration at that given moment in time t. Now, what exactly is the net force acting on the object? Well, the net force is simply Hooke's law. Negative k times x, where k is the stiffness of our spring, x is the displacement of our object from the equilibrium point, and the negative simply means that the force acting on the object, the restoring force acting on the object, points in the opposite direction of the object displacement. This is equal to mass times the instantaneous acceleration. Now, because we want to figure out an equation, x with respect to t, we have to change the a into x with respect to t. So what exactly is the instantaneous acceleration? Well, it's simply equivalent to the second derivative of displacement function of the position function x with respect to time t. So we replace this a with the second derivative of our position function with respect to t. Now we take the left side of our equation and we bring it to the right side. So we get the following differential equation. So notice that the sum, these two sums, will equal zero. And this equation, this differential equation, is commonly known as the equation of motion for simple harmonic oscillators, such as this object hanging on my spring oscillating back and forth under simple harmonic motion. Now, if we are to find this equation that gives us the position with respect to time, we have to find the following solution to this equation. In other words, we want to find an x such that if I take that x, I plug into the following differential equation, and I get a zero. So does such an x exist? Well, let's suppose that an x does exist that solves the following equation, and that x is given by the following result, where a and this number are simply arbitrary constants that are chosen when our initial conditions are given. So this a is simply our amplitude, this is the phase angle, and this is simply our angular frequency given in radians per second. So let's suppose that this is our educated guess. So we want to figure out if this guess is a solution to this equation. So that basically means that we want to find the second derivative of this function, plug that into this quantity, then plug the x into this quantity, add these two values up, And if that gives me a value of 0, well then, this is one solution to this equation. So let's begin by calculating the first derivative of this equation. So the first derivative is simply negative a multiplied by sine of this quantity multiplied by the omega, because we have to apply the chain rule. So the first derivative is this quantity, and then since we want to find the second derivative of our x with respect to t function, we have to take another derivative of this equation, and we get the following result. Negative a times omega squared multiplied by cosine, because sine becomes cosine, and we have to once again apply the chain rule, so this becomes squared. So, let's take this quantity and replace it with this quantity. So we take this and plug it into here, and then we take the x and we replace the x with this entire quantity, because we set x equal to x with respect to t. So we get the following result. And let's divide both sides by m. So the m's cancel on this side, and we get k divided by m on this side. So notice, for both of these terms, we have a constant. We have the cosine and the a that remains constant. So let's bring that out, and we get the following result. So we get k divided by m minus omega squared multiplied by this constant term that appears on both of these terms. So does this equal to 0? Well, notice this equals 0 only when this quantity is equal to 0. So this is in fact a solution to this differential equation if k divided by m is equal to omega squared. So if this is true, then the equation is in fact a solution because this quantity is equal to 0. So, notice the following. Because our omega is equal to 2 pi times the frequency, and because the period is equal to 1 divided by frequency, well, from this result, we know that the frequency is equal to 1 divided by 2 pi multiplied by radical k divided by m. We simply replace our omega with 2 pi multiplied by the frequency, we rearrange, and we get the following result. Now, if we replace our frequency with 1 over period, we get the following result. So our period is equal to 2 times pi multiplied by the square root of mass divided by k. Now, this equation is important because it tells us that the frequency and period of our oscillating object does not depend on the amplitude. It does not depend on the maximum displacement of the object as it's oscillating back and forth. In other words, if we increase or decrease the amplitude of our oscillation of the object, the frequency and the period will remain the same. Now, what this equation does tell us is, if we change the k or we change the m, the mass of the object, where k is simply the stiffness of our spring, if we change these quantities, the frequency and the period will change. So the frequency and the period does in fact depend on the mass, and it depends on the stiffness of the spring, our stiffness constant, but it does not depend on the amplitude of our oscillation.